Thank you. So let me continue where we pretty much where we stopped last time. So we're looking at Stochastic percolation, and we have I at the exponential one weights in the bulk. We have also the exponential one minus rho weights on the horizontal axis, exponential rho on the vertical axis. Everybody is completely independent of everybody. And we're looking at the longest possible upright path from the origin to some point mm. And we introduced the increments of the last passage time. So I was a horizontal increment. How much longer does it take to get to a vertex than to its left neighbor? And J was a vertical increment. How much longer does it take to get to a vertex than its south neighbor? That was J. And what we figured out last time, after some distributional and other lemmas, is that if you take any southeast sigma and you record the I increments, so the horizontal increments and the vertical increments along sigma, and you record these x variables, which were just defined from the ijs in some particular way, inside this enclosed region, then you have full independence of these variables for any fixed sigma southeast space. And the distributions are that the I increments are always exponential 1 minus rho, the vertical j increments are always rho, and the x's inside here are always exponential 1. And so again, these are fully independent. Okay, that was the conclusion last time. Anybody has any question on this? Okay. Now, let me show you first a few consequences of this, and then what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a landmark proof of one of these scaling exponents, which we saw from Philip's talk. I'm going to do that in detail. So we're going to go down to detailed calculations, and we're going to do all the steps. I hope it's not going to be too boring, but I would like you to see how exactly the stationary business works and how you can exploit all of what we have to find out a lemma like that. Okay, so a few immediate consequences of what we have over here. It's the first one I want to talk about. It's 2.13 in the notes. Here are the notes, right? If anybody wants to follow in printed version, if you have any problems with that, please do let me know.
It's forwarding
fine. Okay, thank you. So you can download the notes. And one more thing before I get into this is that there are a couple of homework problems. All of them except the one which I'm going to tell you in a second should be already available to you. I hope you took a look at some of those. So in the practice class, I'm going to just make a vote, just ask you which one you prefer, and then we're going to just discuss whichever you voted for. Okay. That's the plan. Right, so first corollary is immediately you can find out the expected last passage time. So in this statement, I'm always going to assume this. So I'm always going to assume that you have exponential one minus exponential one. So we're always in the stationary model. In the stationary model, I can ask, what is the expected passage time from zero to mm? So I can ask about the expectation of gmn. And it's going to be completely easy and completely explicit from what we have already, which is, of course, very different from first passage, because there you don't have that. So here it's going to be incredibly easy. Why is it easy? Because gmn is, of course, the sum of the increments. You can say you can pick any path. For example, you can pick a deterministic path like this. That's an option, but of course you could do a lot of different things. So you can go from zero to here and then from here to there and add up all the increments on the way to get to G. So you could say that I'm gonna do a sum from one to M. I'm gonna do a sum from one to M of the I increments, I zero. I'm gonna do a sum from 1 to n, this is height n, of the j increments at that location m. So j of m j. And just by the definition of the i's and j, so remember the i's were, so this guy is g of I 0 minus g of I minus 1 0. When you do the telescopic sum here, you exactly get g of m 0. So all of this is going to be. All of this is going to be, after telescoping out everything, g of m0 minus g of 0, 0, which is 0, just that definition. And then a similar thing happens here, that's just a telescope, right? So you get g of m j minus g of m j minus 1. For each of these terms, if you do the sum, you get g of m n minus g of m 0. And if you add these two up, you do get g of mm. So you just telescope it all the way on the horizontal axis to here and then on the vertical axis. Then of course you could do any other path. It's all fine, right? One very important thing, and I'm gonna emphasize this over and over again, that these two sums, so this is a sum of IID exponentials, all right? And this is another sum of IID exponentials. But these two sums are very, very, very much depending on each other. They are not independent at all. I can have independence on southeast path, but this is not a southeast path. Okay, so these guys are very strongly dependent. These guys are very strongly dependent. That's important because that's not a southeast path. However, expectation doesn't care about dependence, right? Expectation of the sum is the sum of the expectation, whether it's dependent or not. So immediately I can apply an expectation on that. And immediately I can have, these are the RID, so it's gonna be M times the expectation of one of these guys, say 1, 0. And these are also IID, so it's gonna be N times the expectation of one of those guys, say JM1. Each of these people is exponential of 7 meter rho and 1 minus rho. So for I get 1/(1-rho), the expectation of the exponential distribution. And for J, I get rho. And so that's the expected last passage time to MM. Incredibly easy, closed form. Everything is really nice. Now, if I was to do the variance, that's of course a far, far, far more difficult business because I do not have independence. So the variance, or in fact, any higher moments will not work this way. Those are non-trivial. So inside the sum, these I's are independent of each other. These J's are independent of each other, but the two across are very dependent. Yeah, okay? Right, so that's easy. And then in fact, from that, I can actually also conclude the law of large numbers, because even though the two sums are independent separately, they are sums of IID things, so they have law of large numbers separately on them. And then I can just add the two law of large numbers. So here is another part of this corollary if you want. So suppose that I'm taking M, I'm gonna have a parameter M, and suppose that this thing is going to x, sorry, this thing is going to infinity. In fact, if I divide by n, then it's going to some positive x. Suppose that n is again going to depend on a parameter n, going to infinity. If I divide by n, it goes to y, again, positive. So what I'm doing here is I'm looking at last passage percolation. And I have a sequence of MN points, which are going off into some direction y over x. And these kind of things we've seen in first passage as well. So I have a sequence of points going out to infinity indexed by M into some direction y over x. And I want to find out what happens to these last passage times as I go along these further and further paths. And the answer is that we do have law of large numbers. As n goes to infinity, if I look at the last passage time to that point, mn and mn, divide this by n, then this will converge almost truly to what you would expect, x for the horizontal coordinate over 1 minus rho plus y over rho. Okay, so you do have law of large numbers straight away. One comment on law of large numbers. So this one is very clear. You just have a sequence of IID random variables. You divide by the number of them, essentially, and you have the law of large numbers. This one is slightly more tricky because these guys are not the same set of random variables. It's not like adding new and new random variables, it's changing it with M all the time. So you change the sequence of the random variables, you add more and more of them, but you always change it to a new independent fresh thing. Traditional law of large numbers directly, I think, does not apply, but there is this force moment law of large numbers, which is easy, or you can do large deviations or anything like that. That's one of the homework problems. Hands up, how many of you have seen the force moment law of large numbers? Okay, so if you can vote on this one, I mean, in the next session, and if you're not seeing that, then we can go through how it's done exactly. It's a very useful tool. So anyway, in the main way or another, you can get these strong laws. This is almost true, yeah. You can get these strong laws, large numbers for the shape, for this last passage percolation, okay? Now, you would start wondering, okay, this looks like the shape in first passage, which we've seen in previous lectures. Are we talking about the shape here? And the answer is not really. We're not really talking about the shape of last passage. First of all, what is this line? So what would you say if you want to keep this like a constant? So if, for example, you want the last passage time over n to be one, what is the shape of x and y's? If you just draw that line, it was a constant, of course, you just get a very boring line like this. So x over 1 minus rho plus y over rho equals constant, just looks like a line like that. I wouldn't call this a shape. So what is going on here really? Why are we not seeing a convex shape like in first passage? Well, the thing is that we distorted everything with this boundary. So the boundary is not the original last passage problem. It's not like the original first passage problem either. This boundary is distorting everything all the way. It's making kind of a stationary version of this whole business. No matter where you go, you actually see the same increment sign j. So everything is kind of stationary in space. And that's what you see by this line. This line is just a straight line, no matter where you go, it's the same straight line. If you wait a bit longer, if you take n, if you take the last passage time a bit longer in that scale, you just see the same line a bit further translated out. So everything is kind of stationary. You don't expect a shape, a convex shape like in first passage. And that's because we modify the weights here. We have larger weights on the edges than in the bulk. Exponential, remember, is less than one, bigger than zero. So these guys are larger. This is also larger, stochastically at least. It's larger than the bulk. You have more weights on the boundary than on the bulk. Okay. So if you want to go somewhere, let me start a new picture over there. Suppose you want to go to a point Mn, and you have these boundaries. So these boundaries are larger stochastically than the bulk, and this is also larger stochastically than the bulk. And you want to get here, what would you do? Imagine you're doing one best pass. You want to collect as many strawberries as you can, right? Well, where would you go? Well, there are not so many strawberries here, but there are lots of them on these boundaries. So what you would do is you would keep on the boundaries for some time. Because that's where the strawberries are, right? You keep here for some time, and you don't want to keep all the way here, because if you come all the way here, then growing up here, you don't have much choice. You just have to get what you see here. So you still want to be able to optimize a little bit over these bulk weights. You still want to find the nice strawberries here. So you keep on going on either the horizontal or the vertical edge, and eventually you decide, okay, now I have enough of these fat strawberries, now I'm gonna go and see what's out there in the bulk. And then you optimize your path to pick as many as you can from here. And that's how you're gonna end up with Mn, okay? But the boundaries being heavier make you stick to the boundary more than you would otherwise, okay? Now, let me just repeat that this is exponential one minus rho, and this is exponential rho. Now, tell me what happens if you increase rho, which is getting larger and which is getting smaller of these two boundaries. So let's increase rho a little bit, which is getting larger. Nope, it's the horizontal one. the larger the row, the smaller this parameter. The smaller this parameter, the larger the exponential distribution. Okay, so this boundary is increasing in row, stochastically at least. And this boundary is decreasing in row. Both of them is larger than the bulk. For any row smaller than zero, bigger than one, both of them is larger than the bulk, right?
Do you see that in the large deviation?
It's going to be some kind of a deviations. I'm not in the exponential level, so I'm not doing large deviations here. I'm going to do something easier than that. But in fact, you can improve these arguments to kind of an exponential level. Okay, so tuning rho, if you increase rho, you're going to push this path a little bit further to the right, stochastically. So it's more likely if you increase rho, this path is going to go more to the right. If you decrease rho, this path is going to exit more on the left. So if you decrease rho, if you increase rho, and eventually you can decrease rho so that the path will prefer this vertical edge instead of the horizontal. If rho is very small, then these weights are really big, at least stochastically. And so maybe you're gonna end up going out from here if rho is small, okay? Now, there is an interesting value, but at least in some kind of average or some kind of expected sense, or maybe some kind of risk-averse sense, you exactly try to exit near the origin. You can play with rho, you can, for a small rho you're here, for a large rho you're there, you can tune rho continuously. Eventually there's gonna be a rho where more or less you want to exit from here. Not exactly here, you still want the fat strawberries around here, but you don't really have a tendency to stay for a long time on the boundaries, right? So you can tune rho so that you do your best with rho to try to force the longest path to exit from the corner, from the origin. Not stick too long for the boundaries, okay? And that rho will be special. It's not completely clear how to define this rho, at least on the microscopic sense. Everything is random, everything fluctuates, right? But if I look at this deterministic little flat numbers picture, then it's kind of clear how to find this rho. Yes?
So if n equals n, then I accept.
Correct.
If that's the case, then still the weights along the boundary are twice, you know, expected to be twice as high.
So yes.
Why would you not still want to go down one of those
edges? You would. You would stay on one of these edges. But the thing is, which we don't yet see, but we're going to see it by the end, hopefully by the end of this course, is that you're going to stick only a microscopic time. You're not going to stick a time proportional to M and N, it's going to be a smaller power of length that you're going to stick here in that case. So if you find the correct row, it turns out that's a bit jumping forward. It turns out that you're going to stick here M to the 2/3 length if you find the correct row. If you don't find the correct row, then you're going to stick here for a length proportional to M or N, so linear power of M and N. Very good question. Okay. But let's just stay on this lower flange numbers level. So if you exit from close to the origin, in fact, you don't spend any linear time, any linear distance on the edges, then what you would expect is that there is not much contribution from the boundary to the last passage time, right? If you don't really grace here with the fat strawberries, then it's almost like not even having the fat strawberries here, just forgetting about the boundary altogether, okay? And that's the interesting rule which we're gonna take a look at now. So, and rho, at least in the law of large number sense, where you don't really want to stick on the boundaries too long, okay? Where not sticking the longest path does not stick too long on the boundary. In other words, find rho where there is not much contribution from the boundary. the minimal possible contribution from the boundary. I mean, if you stick for a long time, then of course you collect a lot of strawberries. Let's try to find rho with minimal contribution. So what I'm doing here is not precise. This is not a theorem, this is not a proof. It's just some kind of intuition which I want to give you. Okay, just a short intuition. Find where the minimum contribution to at least where this law of large numbers limit, law of large numbers limit, which was x over 1 minus rho plus y over rho. Fix x and y, so you have a direction. Fix x and y, and try to find the rho that contributes the least for this law of large numbers limit. That's an easy optimization exercise. It's pretty clear that you're going to have an optimum. If rho is very close to zero, then this term goes up. If rho is very close to one, then that term goes up. So there should be a minimum in between, maybe more minimums. You do the derivative, you solve, everything is zero. I guess somebody can do this. So I'm not going to do that. And what you find, the minimizing rho, I'm going to go over to the other side. What you find is that, I think I'm going to keep this here, is that the minimizing rho satisfies the following. I'm going to call it rho naught. And this satisfies that y over x equals to rho naught square over 1 minus rho naught all thing squared. Okay, this is something you can check very easy. Or you can also solve this for rho naught. Rho naught equals to the square root of y over the square root of x plus the square root of y. Again, this is not a proof, this is just some intuition of what could possibly go on in last passage. It turns out that if you set this density for a given direction, that will kind of make the smallest contribution of the boundary, that will kind of make the path exit closest to the corner. Yes.
So what exactly are you minimizing there?
I'm doing something extremely simple, right? I'm fixing x and y, the direction, and I'm minimizing this thing here. I'm minimizing the lower large number limit of the last passage time in rho. Okay, so
the right thing to do. Yeah. Why is it the right thing to do?
I don't claim it's the right thing to do, it's just an intuition, right? My intuition is the following. If you collect if rho is very large, then you're gonna collect fat strawberries from here, and you're gonna exit there, and you're gonna like this better than exiting from the origin. Because there are lots of fat strawberries, right? If rho is very small, then there are lots of fat strawberries here. So you're gonna stick to this boundary and exit there, and we're gonna like it better than going out from the origin. I don't want you to collect fat strawberries, okay? I want you to stick to the boundary, to the bulk here. And my only tool is tuning rho. So I'm gonna tune rho that you don't really want to stick to either of these axes. I want to tune rho that you want to exit from here. Okay. And that's my hope of getting close to a model without boundaries, where you don't have the fat strawberries at all on the boundary. Okay. I'm not proving anything, it's just a claim. But these arguments can be made rigorous, actually. Okay. So I want to exit from here, more or less from here. I want to deprive you from these fat strawberries. And for this reason, I'm going to tune you to exactly this parameter, which at least in this law of large number sense makes the whole limit there minimum. Okay. Right, so this direction here is called the characteristic direction. Characteristic direction for the density law, although not if you want. Okay, so if you give me a boundary, then I can ask this question another way, right? I can also say, okay, let's fix the boundary and find the direction of this point, which doesn't really make you eat the fat strawberries on the boundary. That's going to be this direction. Okay? So that's the characteristic direction for rho naught. And actually, if you plug in this rho naught back into that formula, then you do get the shape for last passage percolation. So if you plug this thing back into the low flash numbers formula, you could also say that, you could also say that this is the characteristic density for this direction, right? So it goes back and forth. If you plug rho naught in that low flash numbers formula with this rho naught, we have, or with this rho if you want, we have that the limit of g mm and mm over m converges almost surely to, I think you get the square root of x plus the square root of y squared. And that is the shape of last passage percolation. So if you start a model without boundaries, then you get this shape. The exact same way as we had, as we saw the shape for first passage, we always said, okay, there should be a convex, you know, non-empty interior compact shape. This is the one for last passage. It's completely explicit. Okay? I'm not proving anything here, just some intuitive arguments, but these kind of things can be made rigorous. In fact, you have this argument rolled out in, I think it's a chapter in the book by Timo. And as far as I understand, he also has this separately in as a preprint on archive. So if you download this this PDF, it's going to be reference 17 there. Let me not put everything there. It's by Timo Seppelainen, lecture notes on the corner growth model 2009. I believe, as far as I remember, this is, no, it's not the one, sorry, it's the variational formula. Sorry. Variational formulas, Boosman functions from 2017. That's what I wanted to put there. If you look there, is, I think all of these arguments are worked out nicely. Okay, I'm not going to go into these details here, but I think it was worth kind of just giving you some intuition. Now, any questions on this? Any further questions? Okay, the next comment I want to have before we proceed is that I mentioned some connections with exclusion and MM1Qs, I believe, I hope, which again is something I'm not going to go into. If anybody is interested, I can tell you outside class. In those models, you have a characteristic velocity, which is connected to various things, including hydrodynamic scaling, including something called the second class particle. That characteristic velocity exactly maps into this characteristic direction when you make the analogy between the models. So whatever is characteristic here is also characteristic in the corresponding particle models. So it's not by accident that we that this direction is important. Okay. Now, let me tell you a few words about what's coming. So I want to find out about the variance of GMM, which is far more difficult than the expectation, okay, in the stationary model. And the picture will be that if I set rho to something non-characteristic, if I spend a lot of time with the fat strawberries is just an IID one-dimensional line of strawberries, right? They have a central limit theorem, they have a rho of flash numbers. The central limit theorem will dominate all of this variance, all of these fluctuations, if I spend a long time on the boundary. I mean, if I go almost to this horizontal coordinate, then I spent a lot of time with IID strawberries, and then I start to do a very easy optimization for the bulk. I'm just going to see a central limit theorem and the lower flash numbers. Okay? So to see something interesting, I am going to stick with this characteristic rho, which makes me exit the boundaries quite close to the origin. as close as possible in some sense. Okay, and that's when I'm gonna see interesting things. So I'm gonna stick to the characteristics. It's gonna be important for what I want to say. This is when you see the most interesting things. This is the most interesting case. Again, why is this the most interesting? Because that's where you don't really, you're not really collecting most of your strawberries from the boundary. You see something, you really do an optimization inside the ball. Okay, sure.
So if, let's say that you have a row that makes you go halfway along the boundary and then up.
Yeah.
It's not obvious to me unless I know what the order of the fluctuation is for.
I completely agree, it's very non-obvious, yes. We're gonna do a proof for almost. That's exactly the case. There's nothing that shows you this at this moment. So I agree, it's not obvious. What is going to happen is that indeed by optimizing among a lot of paths, you can make the fluctuations smaller than the normal central limit fluctuations. That's exactly the picture. So as soon as you exit the boundary, you're gonna see smaller fluctuations and different scaling limit of fluctuations. And you don't want to suppress that with the boundary strawberries. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, a few more references. So what I'm going to tell you from now on is from our paper with Eric Cutter, myself and Timo. From 2006. Again, there are more advanced arguments. So, but this is what I'm going to base everything on because I think that's simple enough to present here at least part of it. This thing was inspired by a paper by Cutter and Peter Grimmendon from 2005 or 2006. I think it also appeared in 2006. It's reference 3 in there. Let me quickly check. So that was on the Hanson process, which is a very similar, 2006. That was on the Hanson process, which is a very similar model, except it works with Poisson points in two dimensions. And that's where these kind of proofs, as far as I understand, appeared first. And from there, we could generalize it to last passage, and then it went over to polymers, it went over to particle systems. So and lots of versions of this proof. These are the original references. A couple of. Yes, that's right. As far as I know, Grimmendon was looking at the maximum of a Brownian motion minus a parabola. And somehow this led to all of these proofs. I'm not exactly able to tell you where the Brownian motion, where the parabola is, but on a very philosophical level, this has a curvature that plays the role of the parabola, and the Brownian motion is my boundary. I won't say more on this, but I'm hoping to do at least sketches of a proof, which will show you this thing. So that was done for the Hanson process, a slightly different process. And another thing I wanted to mention is that there are other stationary last passage models. They are not very well known, but you can check the work of Czech, I think, and Georgiou from 2017, 18, maybe 19. Let me again check quickly. It's all in the notes, 18 and 19. This is some kind of a special Bernoulli kind of last passage percolation, but it's not just nearest neighbor. You have a slightly more complicated rule for how to make the longest pass, and they can do a stationary version of that as well. And another, finally, in polynomial models, I'm not going to go into polynomials. There's a usual teacher on polynomials. I want to mention Schumann and Mach. I should have put the years here, sorry, I always have to look them up. 18. We actually give a full characterization, as far as I know, a full characterization of what kind of stationary polymer models there are there, and there are four of them. There are four different distributions for polymers where, with which you can do this trick. Okay, so these are a couple of references. Of course, there is a lot more. So a lot of other things are done in stage, a lot of things are done in polymers. I'm not going to list all of them, but these are a few starting points. Right, any questions? Okay, so let's jump into a proof. So what I want to show first is one of these fluctuation identities, which Philip showed us already. And I want to actually give a full proof of that. So we're going to go into all of the details. So fluctuation identity. What I want to do here is I want to connect the fluctuation of the last passage time to the fluctuation of the past, the longest past. So how much it goes left and right. Relate that to the fluctuation of the longest pass, the G weight of the longest pass. Okay. Let's start with another boundary. So this was my boundary, and I'm going to start calling things according to directions. So this I'm going to call south. This is going to be west. And I'm going to refer to south and west boundary by, you know, the boundaries on those edges. So let's modify the south boundary. Let's define from the IRD exponentials we already had, right? So we had already these guys, IRD exponential 1 minus rho. Let's define some new variables from this. I'm going to do something very trivial, very easy. I'm going to define a constant multiple of these guys for I positive. So here we have the boundary weights, exponential 1 minus rho. And I'm going to put another set of boundary weights, which I'm going to call psi. And they are just in a multiple by 1 minus rho, 1 minus lambda of omega I naught. So here I'm assuming that lambda is a number bigger than rho, but still smaller than 1. Who can tell me what the distribution of these guys are? How are these psi distributed? Exponential 1 minus lambda, exactly. So a nice feature of the exponential distribution is that if you multiply it with a positive number, it still stays on exponential distribution. Then all you need to do is find out the expectation. The mean is reciprocals. So if you do the mean, you end up with 1 over 1 minus lambda. That proves that these guys are RID exponential of 1 minus lambda. Okay? I did a pretty stupid thing. I just multiplied all of the south boundary by a constant factor. So it's nothing fancy. I just boosted a little bit up the south boundary. Now it's an easy calculation that if you look at the variance of psi I zero minus omega I zero, this is just going to be, after a few lines of calculations, 1 minus lambda, one minus lambda minus 1 over 1 minus rho squared. It's really easy. It's just, this difference is just 1 minus this much of the omega. You do the variance, the constant factor comes out as square. You do the variance of exponential, that's what you get, right? Okay. Now, what is my new model? So I'm going to look at a new model of last passage percolation that uses these weights. So I'm going to have two models, the original one and the new one which uses these weights, right? So the new model we'll have the same boundaries on the vertical. So still the original omega zero j exponential, exponential rho. And I have these new psi's, I zero exponential one minus lambda. Okay, is this a stationary model? And the answer is no, this is not a stationary model because the boundary waves here do not match in distribution with the boundary waves there. Stationary model has to have the sum of these two parameters equal the parameter inside here, which is still exponential one. So this is not stationary. Okay, to make it stationary, which I'm not doing at the moment, I will do this later, but not yet. To make it stationary, I would have to change these weights as well from rho to lambda. Then it would be stationary. Okay, I'm not doing that. Right. Okay, now what I want to find out is exactly the exit point from the boundary. So exactly how long am I going to stick with the fat strawberries? And when is it that I'm going to go out to the bulk and try to optimize my path in the bulk to collect the best possible from there? So here is the argument. So let's make some definitions to make sure we know what we're talking about. So we're going to have this last touch this picture, and I'm going to do this for both the original model and this modified, this new LPP. So I'm going to say that if you exit somewhere at this point, then you're going to collect some weights on the boundary. Or if you exit somewhere here, maybe for another pass, then you're going to collect some other weights on that boundary. If this is point X, which in this picture is positive, it's an integer, positive integer, then I'm going to say that the weight collected on the boundary is UX. So it's going to be just the sum from 1 to X of omega I naught. This is the weight you collect on the boundary if you exit at point X. Or if you exit here, I'm going to call this minus X. And then we're going to assume that X is positive here. I'm going to assume that X is negative there. That's just notation. And then I'm going to imagine that I exited somewhere here at location minus X, which is positive. Okay. And in this case, I'm collecting weight U of X equals to the sum from one to minus X, which is positive. It's just some notation we have of omega zero j. So it's nothing fancy, just saying that this is how many strawberries you collect on the vertical axis. So in total, together, I have this notation that the weight collected on the boundary X positive part and X negative part for any X in Z, X equals to zero is not interesting, is the last passage time, of course, to this point, X positive, X negative, is just some stupid notation, really. And it's going to be just repeating from there the omega I zeros when X is positive and the omega zero J's when X is negative. So it's just N zero when X is zero. So it's just a short notation to handle all situations when X is positive, then I exit on the right and I collect this many weights on the right. X is negative, I exit on the vertical and I collect that many weights on the vertical, just notation. The other ingredient I'm going to need is the X plus is the positive part and X minus is the negative part. So when X is positive, then X plus is X. Okay. And then this is always positive, right? X minus is, yeah, sorry. So that's just positive part, negative part. It's just notation. I'm always going to use expositive, so it's not going to bother us too much. And the other definition I want to make, 3.3, is the weight collected in the bulk. So far I have the weight collected on the axis. So these will be used. And once I'm out from here, I want to find out the most possible weight I can collect to MM. And that's what I'm going to call AX. So AX is going to be the maximum of an upright pass. So pi is still an upright pass, going from X positive part, X negative part. So this is, again, nothing fancy. This is just the point where I exit the axis, right? The exit point, going from here to MM. The most possible weight I can collect. Now, how long is this pass? If it went from the origin, it would be m plus m long. It exits somewhere x. So it's going to be m plus m minus x long. If x is positive, it's minus x. If x is negative, it's minus negative x of omega at pi k. So this is simply the weight collected in the bulk. It's nothing else but the most weight you can collect in the bulk. Okay. And then here is the simple observation, which we're going to do all the time. GMM in the, let's just talk about the original last passage for the moment. We're going to transfer over to this modified last passage as well. GMM is actually optimizing on X between these two things. So it's going to look at the largest possible sum of the weight collected on the boundary plus the weight collected out in the bulk. That's what the last passage time is. You're going to optimize on how long you want to stay on the boundary, how long do you want the fat strawberries for, and then what's the best point for you to exit the boundary and go out in the bulk to optimize what you see in the bulk. That's going to be AX. Is this step okay with everybody? Now, we're talking about continuous distributed weights. So exponential, one minus two exponential, they're all continuous distributions. The probability of any two parts collecting the same weight is zero, because it's continuous. So there's going to be a unique solution to this maximum problem. There's going to be a unique maximizer where you want to exit. There's going to be a best point to exit the boundary. It could be a horizontal, it could be vertical. There's going to be a best point almost surely. Of course, it's random. And therefore, the optimizer is, I'm going to call Z. So Z is the almost truly unique optimizer for this maximum. That's the exit point. That's where we want to exit. Oops, exit point. Okay, so you exit at Z, you collect the bulk rate until Z. It could be horizontal if Z is positive, or vertical if Z is negative. And from there on, you collect the bulk weight, which I do on the A. Right, so these are all the preliminaries, the definitions. And now I'm going to start telling you about the lemma and start proving the lemma, which I really want to prove. The lemma says that the variance of the last passage time for a fixed MN has two different expressions. One of them is N over rho square. So I'm talking about the original stationary model, not the modified one. N over rho square minus N over 1 minus rho square plus 2 over 1 minus rho times the expected weight collected on the boundary, assuming that you exit on the right-hand side. So when you exit on the vertical, you don't get any contribution. It's the expected weight you collect on the horizontal axis, which might be zero if you exit on the vertical axis, okay? And it's also equal to m over one minus rho square minus m over rho square, plus two over rho, expected weight you collect on the boundary if you exit on the vertical. If you exit on the vertical, then z is negative. So minus z minus is equal to z, right? So in both cases, it's just u of z. Except you look at this, so this one is non-zero when it's when you exit here, this one is non-zero when you exit there. All right, that's the lemma. Now, notice that g is the Laplace-ish time. The fluctuations of g is has this exponent, which we denoted before, which Philippa denoted before by 2 chi. And this is kind of a pulse fluctuation. The weight collected at the boundary is almost the same as the location you exit, so at the exit point z. Just there is a minus the sequence of exponentials between the two, so it's really almost the same thing. So this is almost like these guys are almost like the wandering, was it called a wandering exponent? The pulse wandering exponent psi. And this is one of the scaling relations which we saw before, 2 chi equals to psi. So this number is really proving one of the 2 KPC scaling relations. Okay. So let's prove it. And again, as I said, we're gonna jump into all the details, all the technical details. So we're gonna go all the way to this proof because I want you to kind of have a feeling of how you can use stationary at the end and you know how it comes up. And I think that's probably the best proof to show that. Okay. So again, we have this last passage picture. Let me draw it once more. So here is M, here is M. We have the stationary boundaries of parameter rho. Here is the corner. And so we have exponential 1 minus rho. We have exponential rho. We have exponential 1 here. And we have all these last passage times, GMNs or GIJs. So I'm going to pull the west boundary W, the south boundary S, the east boundary E, script E, and the north boundary north. So here's the actual definitions. What do I mean by boundary is the sum of the increments along those edges. So west is just going to be G of 0 n. So how long does it take from the origin to get to this point? That's going to be west. Then similarly, south is going to be G from 0 to, from 0, 0 to mm, sorry, m0. So how long does it take to get to this point, right? That's going to be south. Then north is going to be the difference, the Laplace increments from here to there. We could also say it's a Boltzmann function, really. So what is the Laplace increment between these 2 points on the north side? So there's going to be G of mm minus G of 0 m. And finally, east is the Laplace increment on here, G mm minus G m 0. So these are just abbreviations which will be useful. What do we know? What's the distribution of W, the west boundary? What's the distribution of the west boundary? Gamma, right? Gamma of parameters n many exponentials added up each with parameter rho. How about the south boundary? Same story. Gamma of n many independent exponential 1 minus rho added up. Right? What's the distribution of north? So now comes that lemma. That lemma tells me that any sigma southeast pass sees IID exponential increments. For example, this pass here as sigma sees IID exponential increments. So in the north, I still have IID exponential 1 minus rho according to that lemma we proved last time. So I still have IID exponential 1 minus rho here. And I still have IID exponential 1 minus rho on the east corner, east boundary, exponential rho IID on the east boundary. That's due to that lemma. Okay? Now, is west and south independent? Are west and south independent? Of course, by definition. That's my definition of the boundary. So by def, west and south are independent. Okay? Now, is north and east, are north and east independent? By dilemma, yes. By dilemma, since this is already sigma, southeast pass over sigma, north and east are also independent. Okay? How about west and north? Are west and north independent? They are not. How about west and east? Again, not independent. How about south and north? Not independent. South and east, not independent. Okay? So anything else, there are six combinations of what can or cannot be independent. Anything else is not independent. These are the only independent things. Okay? So let's start writing out the variations of G and M. What is G and M? There are two different ways to get there in this picture. I'm going to use west plus north. If I add west plus north, I get to GMM, right? Just add these two up, you get GMM. So it's going to be the variance of west plus north. I could also do south plus east. Doesn't matter. I'm going to do this one. Okay, so what is this? Well, there's the variance of west plus the variance of north plus twice the covariance. Again, west and north are not independent, so the covariance is important. Okay, equals to variance of west, variance of west. That's easy because west itself is a sum of IID, so that's easy. Variance of north, that's again easy. What did I put here? Sorry. This is north, right? This is north, sorry. Variance of north. Again, that's easy. North is the sum of IID, so that's easy. And this covariance is the important part. That's the difficult bit. So for covariance of west and north, I'm gonna rewrite west. How can I rewrite west? So if I look at elasticity time, west plus north, it's going to be the same as the last plus each time going south plus east, right? Going that way is the same as going this way. So I can solve this for west. West is going to be south plus east minus north. Let's put that in here. So I have twice the covariance. So I'm putting this in here. Twice the covariance of south and north. I have twice the covariance of east and north, and I have minus twice the covariance of north and north. Just plugging in this and using that covariance is linear. Now, what can I say about covariance of east and north? That's zero by independence. What can I say about covariance of north and north? That's the variance. I had the variance with a plus, here I have it twice with a minus. So I can collect them together. And I'm gonna get rid of this. I can collect them together and find that this whole thing is equal to variance of west, variance of north. Then I have I had minus two variances of north. So this one comes with a minus. This one was zero, and I have twice the covariance of south and north. Okay, so that's the first step I wanted to make. Right, any questions so far? Okay, so now comes the modified last passage. So next, we're going to take a look at this modified last procedure a little bit. First of all, we're going to concentrate on the size boundary, the original size boundary. Well, the original and the modified size boundary. So this was south. And this had these IID exponentials in there. Okay. And recall that we had these. I'm going to actually look at the xi, the xi 0i. which were exponential 1 minus lambda IID. I'm going to assume that lambda is just slightly bigger than rho and still smaller than 1. So epsilon will be, sorry for that, this is my epsilon, and this is my E. Okay? So epsilon will be just a small parameter. I'm going to increase rho a little bit, and that's how I get to lambda. So I'm going to perturb rho a little bit to get lambda. And so really, this is just the exponential of 1 minus rho minus epsilon IID. And now I want to find out the density of the new south boundary. Anything perturbed like this will have an epsilon superscript. So I'm going to denote by epsilon all of this perturbed boundary and anything connected to the perturbed boundary. Okay, so what is the density of the south boundary perturbed by epsilon? So with these exponential 1 minus lambda things at some point s. So what is this south boundary again? It's the sum of IID exponentials, right? Sum of IID exponentials is gamma. Everybody knows the gamma density. So it's going to be 1 minus rho minus epsilon. So this is the parameter of my exponentials to how many I have of them. And then s to the n minus 1 exponential of minus 1 minus rho minus epsilon times s, whole thing divided by n minus 1 factorial. That's the gamma density for the south boundary. Okay? If I differentiate this, I'm going to denote the derivative with respect to the parameter epsilon. If I differentiate this f of s epsilon s, what I get is s times the same thing minus m over 1 minus rho minus epsilon times the same thing s. Right? I'm differentiating means that epsilon, not s. So when I do that, I get an m factor down here, and that's, I guess, the and one less of a power. So this is the second term, and I get something from the exponential. That's the first term. That's how I differentiate that. Okay, why did I do that? Because the gamma distribution has some very nice feature. And again, this if you know Poisson processes, or maybe from other ways, you can easily remember that. So it turns out that if you sum exponentials, you get gamma. If you tell me the sum of those exponentials, you tell me the sum of the gammas, then the points you have inside will just be order uniform. Okay, that's the order statistics property of the Poisson process. If you fix the last point in a Poisson process, the fixed number of points, the end point, and you look what's in before that, what you see is the order statistics of uniform distribution. In particular, what you see does not depend on the parameter you had before for the Poisson process. Okay, so the order statistics property says property for Poisson processes tells you that if you fix the value of S epsilon, then the points before that, so S epsilon consists of the sum of these IID exponentials, under this condition, the conditional distribution of these exponential psi I zeros, of which you added at the south boundary, is not dependent on the parameter epsilon anymore. It's just order uniforms is independent of the parameter epsilon. Is this step okay with everybody? So the south boundary is the sum of these IID exponential psi's. If you fix the total number of them, the total sum of them, then where they are located inside that total sum will not depend on the original parameter. In particular, In particular, it's actually indistinguishable of omega. Once you fix this sum, it doesn't matter if you started with psi or if you started with omega. You get the same thing. Okay? Is this step all right with anybody? So whatever you do, whatever last passage percolation you look at, if you fix the size boundary, the original last passage percolation and this modified last passage percolation will exactly do the same thing. Okay? Right. Hence, we have the following. If you look at the north boundary in the modified model, so M epsilon is the north boundary in the modified prepared model, you condition this on the size boundary being equal to S. This will be the same as in the original model. The conditioning makes kills all the difference between the original model and the modified model. So if you condition on the size boundary, you cannot say, you cannot tell anymore that this is the modified model, not the original. Is that okay? So that's the first observation. All right, so now what I want to do is I want to look at the expected north boundary in the perturbed model. So I perturbing south, I'm changing this into south epsilon, and I want to see what happens to north. Okay? In fact, I want to look at the derivative when epsilon is zero. And here's what I can do, is the derivative when epsilon is zero of the expectation of north, which I write as a tower rule. Expectation of north given south. Okay? What is this? So this is the derivative. So I'm gonna write out this expectation here. This is the integral of whatever I have inside. With the density of south. That's what the expectation is. Okay. Now comes this observation here. Inside that integral, I can replace that expectation by the non-perturbed expectation. Because once I fix the value of size, I can't tell the difference anymore between perturbed and non-perturbed model. Should I erase that? I'm gonna erase that.
Everybody remember something.
Okay. Next, I'm going to plug in what I have. Well, okay, sorry. Next, I'm gonna bring this derivative inside. You can convince yourself that this is already, it's okay to bring this derivative inside. The expectation of north given south does not have epsilon anymore, so the derivative crosses that just freely, and the derivative applies on the density. Which I can plug in from the left-hand side, and I end up with integral from zero to infinity, expectation of north given south. And then I have, what do I have? S times the density. And I have this other term of a constant, it's a minus, a constant m over, what is that? One minus rho minus epsilon. One minus rho minus epsilon, but I'm taking epsilon to zero at the end. So the minus epsilon is not really here. Times the integral from zero to infinity, expectation of north given south, and just the density, right? Yes. Okay. Now let's see if you can read formulas. What is this? What is this? Exactly. Expectation of north times south. Right? What is this? expectation of norms. And what is this? Expectation of sounds, which is the same as the expectation of norms, but let's keep it this way. So I have expectation of norms sounds minus E of norms, E of sounds, which is quite nice. Each has the covariance between norms and sounds. So this term here, which is the interesting term, got an expression as a derivative of the expected value of norms under this perturbation.
Magic.
Yes.
Why is that
magic? I would say that that's the magic of the gamma distribution. I don't really have a good answer, really.
How do you know this was the right for derivative to look at?
Well, I mean, we've seen already some perturbative arguments, right? Perturb one edge, see what happens. Now here I'm doing almost the same thing. Perturb the south boundary, see what happens in the north. So kind of taking the derivative at perturbation equals zero seems a natural step. As once you have this nice, you know, stationary structure, it seems natural to try this, right? And then just eventually you get to this covariance. I don't have a better feeling about it. I don't know if anybody has, maybe. I don't have a better feeling about it. I mean, some magic needs to happen, right? In Italy, the probability the magic is that you can rewrite everything into determinants. In here, the magic is this. I don't know. But I think it shows what you really want out of a stationary model. You want something like this. You want to be able to handle perturbations. What happens if you enlarge a little bit one of the boundaries, how does that propagate forward in the model? You want to get some kind of handle on that. That's what you're looking for in a stationary model. I don't have a better intuition on this question. Okay, so I'm going to start a next argument for the same covariance. For the same derivative, for the same time derivative. So we're going to look at the same derivative of expected norms in a different way. Okay, we're going to look at the derivative of norms, expected norms, in a different way. And I'm sure I can't finish this today, but let's just start. Okay, so let's rewrite a little bit. Let's draw this picture again. Let's draw this picture again. So here is south. I modify it to be south epsilon. Here is unknown. And there used to be an exit point before, which I call Z. And as I modified south with south epsilon, the exit point might stay the same, or you actually might enjoy the fatter strawberries a bit more. So remember, I increased the south boundary. So south epsilon is actually bigger than south because it's a constant factor. It's a factor larger than one times the other, okay? So you might still exit here, or you might enjoy the fatter strawberries a bit more and exit later. That's Z epsilon. So Z epsilon is either Z or Z epsilon is bigger than Z. Because it's a deterministic change, this is a constant multiple of S, it's deterministic. Z epsilon can never be smaller than Z. If you increase the size of the strawberries, you will never leave the field, right? You will either leave the same time or enjoy the fast strawberries more. Okay, so that's the first observation. And let me just write up this much and then I'm going to stop for today. So N of epsilon minus the original, so north, the modified north minus the original north, I'm just gonna write this much. It's the difference times the indicator that the exit point didn't change plus the same difference times the indicator that the exit point did change. So that epsilon did change, it's not Z. And if it's not Z, then in fact it has to be bigger. Okay? So I have to stop here now. We're gonna continue from here. I'm going slower than I expected. So I still want to do this proof fully tomorrow. And then we're gonna sketch the rest of the proof to see the two-third scaling of fluctuations. Okay. After the break, we're gonna have the tutorial. And I would like you to think about which of the homework problems which are in these notes you want to see discussed in the tutorial. So my plan is to discuss it on the board. So I'm gonna talk through some of these problems, but I'm going to ask you which one you prefer. Okay, so see you in 15 minutes, I guess.